Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Grand Line. I am your host, DreadnautX. With me, as always, the champion of the North Star, Count Vamps. On tonight's episode, we join the Jaegers and discuss Sirius the Jaegers on Netflix, as well as we send our love to Jojo and his bizarre adventures. Episode 5 starts right now. So yeah, how's everything going, man?
Yeah, things good. Can't complain. Lots of fun. So, you know, everything is good. How about yourself?
Too bad, man. Just enjoying this anime rush I've been going through lately.
Yeah, it's pretty fun to find new stuff. So.
Yeah, it's like I try and get through some of my old stuff. Like I'm still trying to work on JoJo's Bizarre Adventure Season 2. And, man, things just keep popping up, and then I start getting into them, and it's like, I have a hard time going, I have a real bad habit of, like, listening to, or watching a podcast, or watching an anime, and then getting sidetracked and not finishing them.
Yeah, I know exactly how you feel. I tend to do the same thing as well.
Now you got, like, Stranger Things Season 3 coming out that I want to watch, and it's like,
trying to prowl. Yeah, that's on my list. I haven't actually seen it yet, so
yeah, that'd be something I have to watch with the wife during the week. So
yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so how has your anime been this week? Have you watched quite a few things or just a couple or?
I've mostly read manga, but I did watch some Dragon Pilot, it's called, which well, it tried, I guess.
That good, eh?
Yeah. I still gotta watch two more episodes of it, but oh, it's lucky I have the 3-episode rule because it wouldn't have got past episode 1, to be completely honest. And I've also caught up with One Punch again, so there was about 4 or 5 issues I hadn't read, so now I'm back up to date.
Ah, cool.
And I've been reading a manga called Vagabond, which is about the famous duelist Minamoto Musashi, who was a pretty famous samurai duelist just after the Sengoku period. He had 64 duels, and he was undefeated in all of them. So
nice.
It's a pretty good read, yeah.
Is that manga only?
I think so at the moment, yeah. Cool. I'll keep you up to date if that changes. But, I mean, it's so good I couldn't put it down. I read 150 chapters in, like, Jeez. 2 days.
That sounds good.
So, it's very, very good.
Yeah, speaking of One Punch, it's crazy they announced a One Punch video game.
Yeah, I know. I'm really curious about how Saitama is going to play, like...
It looked very Dragon Ball-esque.
Yeah, because I was watching the thing, and Saitama gets punched, and he doesn't get hit stunned or anything. He's just like...
Whoa. He just stands there.
Yeah. One guy in the comments was like, I bet you when he loses all his health, he's just like, he remembers a sale, and he has to leave. And I'm like, that would actually be a really good explanation of why he stopped fighting.
Instead of losing, he just walks away and goes somewhere else.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, it's like, oh, crap, my local supermarket is having a sale. I just remembered it. And he just, like, runs away from the battlefield.
Yeah, it'd be interesting. It's there's a new Dragon Ball Adventure game, like an RPG coming out. I don't know if you've seen, like, a video of that. And it kind of reminds me of that type of style.
Oh, yeah, cool. No, I have not seen that. So, I'm always looking for new Dragon Ball games. So, because I think it lends itself well to a lot of it lends itself well to a lot of different genres.
Right.
But you know, some of them more successfully than others.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Video
So,
games is
but.
usually sometimes it's usually a safe bet to to put animes into video games. It usually works out pretty good.
Yeah, I found a lot of the animes are doing freaking Dynasty Warriors style games,
Oh, okay.
which I'm not sure if you played Dynasty Warriors, but
That's
you
kind of
know
like
it's
how the One Punch game or One Piece games have gone, right?
yeah, and they're actually really fun to play. I mean, I like don't get me wrong, Dynasty Warriors is not high quality gaming stuff. It's not
Right.
like you know, award winning, but I enjoy just like, you know, booting it up and just smashing about 1,000 people's faces in. And you know, the one punch characters actually lend themselves really well to that. Like, so there's also one for Arsland, which I'm not sure if you've heard of that anime, but it's like a kind of war anime, like fantasy war anime.
No, I've never heard of that.
And it's a really cool anime if you're into battle tactics and stuff like that, and sort of like geopolitical sort of situations. It is really good. I know I kind of just made it sound a bit boring, but it is
Sounds like
quite
Front
good.
Mission. Have you ever played Front Mission?
It's sort of like that, but fantasy and without a
Right.
giant robot, sadly.
That's cool. Yeah, Front Mission was mechs, was it not? It's been a while.
It is. Yeah,
Okay.
Front Mission is.
I remember I used to play a lot of Armored Core back in the day, but.
Armored Core is also really good. That's also made by From Software as well, actually. Dark Souls, which kind of
Oh.
explains the insane difficulty in
Oh, I didn't even realize that. That's made the same people as
it.
made Armored Core?
Yeah, so the guys who made Dark Souls made Armored Core.
That's cool.
Yeah, so it seems like difficult games is their wheelhouse.
No doubt. Yeah, speaking of like just a little bit more news, have you seen this article about Akira?
I have not. I just saw that you put it up.
Yeah, the movie, they're making it into a anime series.
That may actually be pretty good because one thing I always found about Akira was is that there's a few things they didn't explain super well in the movie,
Right.
so I'm hoping that an anime series will expand that kind of those kind of areas where they obviously being a movie you can't really go into things
Right,
too
it's
deeply because otherwise it just turns into a talky-talky movie when it should be about, like, you know, guy exploding movie, so. But it'll be interesting to see what they do, and, you know, I mean, series always give better character development, which is
For
good,
sure,
so.
yeah, they have more time to flesh out the story and characters and everything.
Yeah, exactly. So, I'll certainly give it a watch. It'll be interesting. I normally don't do a ton of research into these kind of things, because, you know, I kind of like to be sort of
Yeah,
surprised,
for
so.
sure.
Also, I don't get aboard the hype train. The hype train has led me to very terrible stations, so I no longer get aboard that train. I'll be like, no, I'll take the less hype train. Like,
Then you end up watching stuff like the Pokemon movie.
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think even before I started watching animes back in the day, like series, I think I watched Akira even before I watched like Record of Lotus War and Berserk and whatever I watched to begin with. I think I even saw Akira before then. So that was probably like one of my first introductions to that style of like work.
Yeah, I think Akira was probably about the fourth anime I saw, so it was pretty new for me. I mean, I thought the movie was pretty good. Don't get me wrong, it does have its
Yeah.
sore parts, I suppose. It's weak parts, but I thought overall it was a good watch, so.
Yeah, I thought it was a pretty good introduction to that
Yeah.
style of show.
Yeah, I definitely agree.
So moving on to I don't know, how do you pronounce that first name?
Sirius the Jaeger.
Sirius, okay.
Yeah, Sirius, yeah. Like Sirius Black from Harry Potter.
Ah, gotcha.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I believe it is actually some form of German,
Okay,
so
probably out.
yeah.
You're a little more
Jaeger
up.
definitely is.
Yeah, for sure. So, what did you think of this very vampire-esque show?
I thought it was pretty good. I think it had a really strong start. I thought they like. I'll chat about sort of like the structure later, yeah. But I thought it had a really strong start. It started out with a good action scene, and then we had a bit of sort of intro, and then we had some more action, and that was a really good first episode. And you know, I think it did really well overall. I like the setting. The only thing I'd say is that by the time we got to the end of the third episode, I was like, I hope they sort of take this in a good direction.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like three episodes wasn't quite enough to get a good sort of encapsulation of the series.
Yeah, they did a weird thing where it's like, you get all that action the first episode, and then they kind of go back, and then there's like a episode where they're just explaining a lot of like backstory, and you're getting a big backstory there in episode three, and...
Yeah,
so
exactly. And it's only 12 episodes long, so I'm kind of curious on where they're going to go with it for the next...
And normally you get a few episodes under your belt before you start explaining some backstory, but they kind of went a little bit heavy on it there. I mean, it's good because they explained the main characters. It's not like they went off and explained like an off character or nothing, but...
Yeah, yeah. Like it was definitely necessary, but it's all about figuring out where you want to put that and where it's appropriate.
Yeah.
I mean, I do a bit of writing in my off time. And Lady Vamps reads it. She's kind of like my proof checker. And I had the same issue in one of my things. She's like, you stop it right here to explain some stuff that happened before, and that's boring. So I rewrote it, and I had that happen after the next chapter instead of before it. And she's like, that reads a lot better now.
Just worked out better, yeah.
Yeah, I think the thing is that structure is very important, and you've got to figure out exactly where you want to put it. And I think you're right. I think the first episode, like... What they should have done is they should have kept the first episode the way it was. They should have had the second episode where you get a bit more action, you know, you get a bit more explanation.
Yeah.
I felt like there was a bit too much explanation. Then you got a bit of action right near the end of the episode.
Yeah,
it was good action. I'm not going to argue that. And then the third episode was all backstory.
Yeah.
So I feel like if you're going to have a whole episode of backstory, you should have had a bit more action in episode two.
Right, or have the episode where you're doing explaining, maybe have that with the backstory as well, so you're not kind of splitting it into two episodes.
Yeah, exactly. Right. And maybe even have it a couple of episodes later. I mean,
yeah, for sure.
Also, I will say this: the one thing I didn't actually like is the cut between the end of episode two and the start of episode three. Because the end of episode two, he's staying on the building with. His brother. I feel that's not too much of a spoiler, let's be honest here. And then it just like cuts to him in his bedroom at the start of episode three, and you're like, what happened? Like, they sort of had a bit of a fist fight on the building, and then they stopped, and then suddenly we're in his bedroom.
Yeah, and I assumed when they went through the backstory they were going to get kind of bring us back up to the rooftop and what happened there, but we didn't get much of a... You know.
Yeah, and then that's exactly what I thought as well. Yeah. Like, and I'm like, okay, so what? How did he get away? Did he just jump off the building?
Yeah,
the
exactly.
Did he beat up Yuli? I believe is the main character's name.
Yeah,
I'll just double check that. I'm pretty sure. Yeah, Yuli.
That's what they call him, anyway.
Yuli. Yeah. So, I do like all the characters. I think they've all got like different abilities, which is nice. So you know, and. Obviously, that's good.
Yeah.
Go
ahead.
Yeah, so I was just about to say we should probably give a bit of a synopsis.
Yeah.
So basically, there's a group of vampire hunters called Jaegers, and they're following a group of vampires who fled to Japan looking for something called the Ark, and the Ark is meant to make the vampires basically unbeatable. So they've got to try and find the Ark and defeat the vampires. And that's basically the plot.
Right.
And the main character is Yuri, and he's something called a Sirius, which seems to be some type of... I won't say werewolf, like the description says werewolf, but he's really more of like a human that can tap into bestial power rather than a werewolf. He doesn't actually transform into a big Hulk and werewolf guy, you know.
Yeah, like, were you expecting that?
Yeah, I was. I was expecting. I wasn't expecting the first episode when he kind of tapped into it temporarily, but at the end of the second episode, I was expecting full blown wolf transformation.
For sure. I was expecting like the underworld type of deal where, you know, he would go full werewolf and at least go into it a little bit.
Yeah, you know, full on world of darkness, Garu form, rip a vampire in half kind of deal. Yeah. You know, like I wasn't, and basically his eyes just look blue and he becomes sort of. Berserker rage is actually what I
I don't know. Like, have you watched much more? I'm assuming that he will get there because the description puts it, he is like a werewolf. They say, right? So,
yeah, I haven't watched any more of it at the moment, but I'm probably. Gonna, I mean, I've got 9 episodes left. I might as well.
Yeah,
shut off at this point. But yeah, like I did think it's a good start. I think though, if I was going to recommend it to someone, I'd probably say if you're completely out of stuff to watch, give it a whirl. Like you know what I mean. I'm not sure if I'd recommend it over other anime.
I thought I recommended a little bit higher than that for myself.
Yeah, I mean I think it's well made. Like if it ends up like after another 3 episodes, it ends up amazing. I'll certainly change my recommendation. Yeah. For sure, which I'm hoping that's what happens. But at this point, I mean, it's got a strong base, but I'd like to see where they build it.
Yeah, I know. I could definitely see where you're coming from. That second and third episodes doesn't do it any favors. They definitely should have changed things up a tiny bit storyline-wise, I think.
Yeah, the first episode is really well done. They have... they start with action, which I always recommend for an anime that's, you know, this kind of anime. Really cool first action scene. Then you have a bit of exposition, which is all right because, you know, you kind of have to. It's And then they bookend it with another really cool chase scene.
Right.
And a bit more action after the chase scene, but not much. But it's sort of like, you know, I'll count the chase scene as a full action sequence kind of thing. Really strong. And then, yeah, the second episode, it had some good themes in it. I like the themes, especially the whole father-daughter sort of thing that they had going on. But, yeah, I just feel like that they didn't really pull it enough for me. And then episode 3 set up a lot of stuff but didn't have much in the way of payoff.
Yeah, I
gotcha. So.
Yeah, I agree.
So, I mean, personally, I mean, I'm definitely going to watch the rest of it.
Yeah.
But, personally, if I was watching this just sort of by myself, I probably would start watching something else, honestly. Like,
yeah.
And I think that's the thing is currently, like, there's a lot of anime out there, and there's a lot of really good anime that starts really well and finishes really well. You've really got to stand out, like, from the crowd. And I think Sirius sort of takes a foot forward, but he doesn't really stand.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. It's definitely hard to recommend something when you have so many other good shows out there that you would recommend right away, for sure.
Yeah, exactly. And see, the thing is that most people, they don't have a 3-episode rule. Most people are like, if it doesn't catch me by the first episode, I'm not interested.
Right.
Lady Gams, for example, she's a 1-episode person, which is fine. I mean, you know, that's all good. I'm a 3-episode person because, you know, there has been a lot of anime that I would have stopped watching after the first episode, and because I kept watching it, turned out it was really good.
Yeah.
But, you know, and I even had this friend who, like, he'd give me his manga volumes because he'd read chapter 1, and if it didn't grab him, he'd just basically throw them out. Like, so he'd be like, here you go. It didn't catch me, so I'm done. And, you know, his thing is that I'm busy. If a show can't be good immediately, it's wasting my time.
Yeah, I gotcha.
I don't agree with that, obviously, but, you know, like, I'd say that I've met more people like him than I have met people who would watch 3 episodes like I do, even 2.
I find you have to give at least a little bit of your time. You have to invest at least a little bit first. In order to get something back, you know?
Yeah, exactly. I totally agree with that. But, you know, like, so for a lot of these animes, they've got to be willing to sort of go, yes, we got to throw our hand down kind of first episode.
Right, yeah.
To some extent.
Right,
which I think Sirius
gets
do
all
well.
That gets all the casuals in, right? Anybody who's only going to watch the first episode, that's where they need to make a big impact, because 80% of the audience who might not be into animes but are just looking for something, you know, that first episode is really what's going to grab at least a majority of the people.
Yeah, exactly. And when you look at series that do that, like One Piece, Dragon Ball, you know, these are the ones that end up becoming insanely popular because they just grab that audience attention. They're like, look, this is what I'm doing, you know? Like, even something like Naruto, which I'm not the biggest fan of. I like it. I'm not insane about it or anything. You know, even I'll say it has a very strong start. The first episode is a strong episode. It sets up who Naruto is, what he's doing, and that he's like sort of like a misunderstood but rather competent sort of character. And that's the thing, is that if you can't set it up immediately, like, you're gonna lose a lot of people. Like,
right.
That's just a sad fact of life. Yeah. Like,
there's just too much out there these days that if you can't do it within the first episode, you are definitely gonna lose a big portion of your audience.
Yeah. Well, it's like a dragon pilot show, which I think I put out, I may have tweeted about it. I can't 100% remember, but it's a show about, like, from the synopsis, it sounds awesome. It's a show about a girl who basically goes inside a dragon and can pilot it like a fighter jet. Like, sounds really cool, you know, and she's one of the select few who can actually do this, and it turns out that the Japanese military have been using these dragons camouflaged for ages to fight battles for them. So, they have armor that makes it look like a fighter jet.
It's really cool. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, exactly. Sounds awesome, right? Like, and that's what I thought, too. I watched the first episode, and I was so bored. Like, I was like, how did you screw this up? You had dragons as fighter jets, and you somehow blew this.
Yeah.
Like, I think one of the major problems, though, is that the main character is... they would have fit in well with the 90s, you know. One of these characters sort of full of self-doubt. They don't really want to do the job that's being kind of given to them and stuff like that. And I really don't like those characters, personally. I find them very sort of boring, because I know if I was given the job to pilot a dragon or a robot, I'd be right in there. I'd be like, let's do this.
Yeah.
Like, so... I mean, I do get it from an adult point of view. They're under a lot of pressure, but... Like, that's why I kind of give Shinji from Neon Genesis a pass, because basically it's like, if you don't pilot this, the world is destroyed. Like, so, you know, put your big boy breeches on and get in there. while this chick is kind of just like, oh, we'd like you to be a dragon pilot, you know, sort of thing. Like, there's no real massive pressure on her to do so.
Right.
So her having like a breakdown, I don't know. Like, I get Shinji's. I still think I'd be like, yes, giant robot, let's punch some people. Like,
yeah.
But I at least get his, because it's like, well, you've never piloted before, and you've got to pilot it, or else we'll all die. That's a lot of pressure for a teenager to take on their shoulders.
That end of the world pressure, like.
Yeah, exactly. Then you got this chick who's just like, I don't want to fly a dragon. I'm like, what is your problem? Like, if someone said, hey man, dragons are real and you get to fly one, I would be like,
sign me up.
Yeah. I'd be like, do I get to pick the color of my dragon, or does it just come in normal colors, you know? Like,
yeah, no doubt.
So yeah, I found it to be really boring, which I think it definitely deserves an award for, like, somehow wrecking one of the most interesting premises I think I've heard.
That's crazy, eh? It's like, now you've ruined it for all of the dragon piling things ever.
Yeah, I know, right? Like, I mean, it wasn't good. Lady Vamps was like, she was done halfway through the episode. She's like, no.
And that's called Dragon Pilot?
Yeah, Dragon Pilot. It's on Netflix. I mean... No, I can't recommend it. I'm sorry. I'll watch two more episodes and then I'll see how I go.
But how was the theme song?
It was all right.
Yeah.
It wasn't anything earth-shattering, yeah. Like, it did its job, at least. I'll give it that much. But considering that's the best thing I can say about the anime at this point, the theme song did its job. Like,
it was no Fifth of the North Star.
No. Or JoJo's. Gotcha. Any of JoJo's, in fact. I've now heard all the JoJo openings now, actually. Yeah. They're all really freaking good.
Yeah. I'm not too fond of season twos. I really got started to really enjoy season ones. Yeah. And like the opera version of it. But number two is still, I'm almost done it now. I got like one episode left and it hasn't got me yet.
Season twos is probably the weakest.
Yeah.
Which is, well, I still think it suits the anime, but
it's
not
horrible.
It's certainly not amazing.
When you come off that first one, and then, you know, hearing all the stuff about number three, it's just, it's not great.
Once you hear season three one, holy crap, like that's probably one of the best openings I've ever heard. I didn't mind the second, because season three is split into two parts.
Right.
I didn't mind the second parts one. I like part four's, so Diamond is Unbreakable. Its original opening, wow, what an opening.
I'll keep my eyes like, on
it. Yeah, pretty much most of the JoJo openings are really good. That's good. I mean, it's pretty rare for me to be able to go, I really can't point at a JoJo opening that I'm like, that is crap. Like, because I can point to Dragon Ball and point out a crap one, and I can point to Naruto and point out several crap ones. Right. And even Fairy Tail like has a couple of...
Don't trash my Fairy Tail opening.
I like most of them, but there's a couple that... We're just like, what were you guys thinking on that one?
I know, especially when you have such a banger for your first one.
Yeah. Freaking, that one is really good. Yeah. And there's a couple other ones that get close to that. And there's one that I think is better, and then the rest.
It's like, what'd you guys find a good one, man? You should just keep it.
Yeah, I totally agree. Especially, I think it's especially bad when you have a really good one, and then the next one is almost like the complete opposite of it. Yeah. So not only is it like, oh, that song is bad, but it's also like it's absolutely nothing like the good song.
Yeah. Can you imagine like The Simpsons or like another show or like Friends or Cheers or like Seinfeld or one of these shows, like they come back for their third season, they just have like this totally bananas off the walls theme song, right? You'd be like, what the fuck is going on here, right? It would be so off-putting, you know?
I mean, because let's be honest here. When you're younger, if you heard that Simpsons jingle in the background, you're like, oh my god, The Simpsons is on!
Right, you run to go watch, right?
Yeah.
But what if they what if they changed up the theme song? You wouldn't even know it's on. You'd just hear it and you'd be like, oh, whatever. I don't know what that is.
You'd walk into the land room with your bowl of soup and you'd be like, what the hell? The Simpsons is on. You'd be like, I missed 15 minutes of it.
Yeah.
You know? Because, you know, as a kid, you don't really have any basis of time,
right?
Like, you hear the theme song,
but you get so used to a certain song that it gets ingrained in your mind, and then when they go and change it up, I still can't get over that, how like all these animes I watched, how often they change up their theme songs.
And anime seems to be the only thing that really does it as well, because I've watched several live action Japanese shows and even Chinese shows, and they don't change their theme songs. Like, so it's really just an anime thing.
And it's not necessarily like changing like anime styles or production companies. Like, it's nothing to do with that. It's just sometimes they always have the same people behind the scenes, but yet they still mix it up.
Yeah. It seems to be almost arc based as well. Like, so when an arc's finished, it's time for a new opening kind of thing.
Gotcha.
It seems to be a pretty common occurrence. I think Fairy Tail actually was one of the worst for keeping the same theme song.
Yeah.
Because the arcs in Fairy Tail are much smaller than other anime arcs. Like, I think the longest Fairy Tail arc is like 30 episodes or something, which is small potatoes comparatively to like 120 or something like that.
Yeah.
So I remember like right near the start when I first started watching Fairy Tail, you know, the first arc's 12 episodes and then they swap theme song. And the next arc is like 8 episodes, and then they like swap theme song again. And then it's like 16, and then they swap. And so basically for like the first like 60, 70 episodes of Fairy Tail, I think they have like about 5 new openings.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Which is pretty crazy. So a lot of the time, you don't even get enough time to sort of digest the fairy tale ones before they're gone, which is a shame because, as I said, a lot of them are quite good.
So. Yeah, exactly. That first, like I said, the first one's definitely good.
Oh yeah, I love that one, man. I actually, funny story. I actually made custom wrestlers in one of the wrestling games, Natsu and Happy.
Nice.
And I actually managed to get the fairy tale opening as their intro music.
How did you make Happy in a wrestling game?
Basically, he's just a giant blue guy with a cat head. Like he's got like cat ears and a tail.
Yeah, yeah,
he's just like a blue dude.
Oh, I gotta see that.
Yeah, so I tried to make his lips super big, so he looks really ridiculous.
You can do some pretty crazy, outlandish things with fighting games these days, wrestling games.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, no, that got a good laugh, because a lot of time, basically, we just made a whole custom league, me and my friends. So yeah. We'd, like, hit the random custom character, and we'd just find out who we had. I believe you also make your own belts in this one, so,
right?
You know, I basically, I think Natsu and Happy were the tag team champions. There's a few other ones, so. But yeah, that was really good. So you know, I used the original opening because I was like, yeah, no, that's definitely the one to use. Like,
I had to
it's also the most recognizable, I reckon.
Yeah,
as well.
For sure. It's pretty iconic. I think that theme song, that first one.
Yeah, yeah. I feel like, you know, fairy, where you going? And like, as soon as I hear that, I'm like, yep, fairy tales on. Yeah. Like,
I know it's you go on TikTok and you type in like hashtag fairy tale, and it's all people doing that pose with their fingers going up into the air with that theme song behind them.
the old fairy tale salute.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a pretty iconic pose too, which is funny because it's really not that sort of unique, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Like it's just basically like you make sort of like an L shape with your hand and
right.
hold it up.
But I mean, if you were to go to like a anime convention or Comic Con, and you like, you know, started doing that slowly and raising your hand in the air, people would know, like, you know, just that simple gesture, right?
People would be able to guess exactly what it's from, which is pretty cool, because I do find that a lot of things is that you know, in anime when they have like some type of secret hand gesture or something, it's always really fun to pull off. Like, but this one is just really simple. That and Jojo poses, you know, you just
oh my gosh. The most outlandish things you could think of in Jojo's.
The funny thing is that I can basically pull off Joseph Joestar's pose like almost immediately now. It's just like ingrained, like I'm just like Jojo pose.
Yeah.
We do it.
Him and his knocker balls.
Yeah, I know, right? Freaking hell. He wrecks people with them. Yeah. It's like I guess, though, like, Caesar wrecks people with bubbles, so...
Yeah, they got quite the strange offense going this season, that's for sure.
Yeah, most certainly. Knockers and bubbles. I mean, that's about it, like, you know. And yeah, they just destroy people with them. It's like,
yeah.
You can't forget the Nazi cyborg either. He's got some...
Yeah, he keeps coming back. You know, he's got LED lights on his shoulders.
Yeah, he just keeps getting more stuff goes on. Yeah. I'm pretty sure his role is just get the shit beat out of him and then come back with more cybernetics.
Yeah. Do you ever see him pass the season?
No, but you do find out what happens to him at the end of the season. Okay, so, which is cool. I also want to give actually the writer of JoJo props for actually making a Nazi character sympathetic. I mean... That's pretty freaking difficult. I mean, pretty much you put Nazi in someone's name and they're immediately a villain.
Well, in the first couple episodes, you're, like, hating this guy, and it's like, then by the time he gets, like, whatever happens to him there at the beginning arc, and then it's like, you don't feel bad for him, because he's a Nazi, but...
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
But, you actually kind of like, oh, cool, he's back, like, when he actually drops back in.
Yeah,
like,
it was pretty cool seeing him again, yeah.
Like, you know, there's a lot of conflicting feelings about it.
Yeah, like, you want to hate him, but it's just like, oh, he's, you know, yeah, I gotcha.
He's just too cool of a guy, like, to fully hate. You're like, I really don't like the fact you're a Nazi, but if you take that out of your character...
Yeah, you'd be a pretty cool stand-up guy.
Yeah. But yeah, like, so I think, yeah, you know, the more I think about JoJo, actually, the more I realize how good of a series it really is.
Yeah.
Like, it's sort of like a fine wine. The more you think about it, or the more it, like, kind of gestates in your brain, the better it becomes. Like, and I just got through Stardust Crusaders. Like, I finished the last episode of that last weekend, I think it was. And holy crap, like, the anime is so well made as well, which is, like, really insane. Like,
I love the fight scenes.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I like how they plan out the fight scenes, and he'll do something, and it will seem like, you know, he had no clue what he was doing. But then, like, 5 minutes later, he'll be like, well, I did intertwine this string upon your leg without you noticing. And then they kind of go back and show all the moves up till then. And it's just, they do a really good job of complicating the fight scenes, but not laying it out to you right away. It's really cool.
Yeah, yeah. Because someone's leg will just fly off and you're like, what the hell happened?
Right.
And JoJo will be like, uh-huh, got your leg. And then he'll explain what he did.
Yeah.
And he'll be like, that was genius, JoJo. Good job. And, yeah, and also, like, Dio is a freaking amazing villain, like, as well, which really helps. Sadly, he's really the only villain that reoccurs, but I guess that kind of makes sense in JoJo's world, because most villains end up exploded or, you know, somehow completely taken out of the equation. So.
Yeah, I know, and even when they do get, like, limb by limb taken apart, they still manage to come back together sometimes.
Yeah, you know, it's, especially the vampire enemies, because they regen, so. But, yeah, like, you know, I just love how Dio is like, it was me, Dio! Like, it's just like, dude, you don't need to announce your name. Like, and he does that a lot.
Yeah.
And he has some really weird things he says, especially in Stardust Crusaders. He's like, you're scrambling for sense like an exam student on the last day of exams. It's like, what the hell does that actually mean? And yeah, like, you know, I think the crazy thing is that, you know, the worst thing I can say is JoJo as a series is that, like, part six is not my favorite part. That's about it.
Yeah.
Like, even part one, which I do stand by the fact that it's not like the strongest part when you compare it to all the other parts.
Right.
But I still think it's a really good part. Like, you know what I mean? And I think you definitely have to, like, a lot of people I've actually heard a couple of people saying, oh, I think I might just skip straight to part three because that's when people say it's good. And it's like, no, you can't do that. Like, there's so much build up in part one and part two and part three. You absolutely need to watch or read part one and part two, you know, like.
Yeah, part one's a bit of a drag just because of the location and the setting and just how it starts off. But once it gets going, it's pretty good.
Yeah, and I mean, Jonathan Joestar is actually a really good character. Like, he's really well written. He's got his sort of character type that he sticks to. You know, he never stops being an English gentleman. He's always an English gentleman, which is, you know, it's really good to see that. Dio is always basically a conniving asshole, which is, you know, perfect for his character. And you know, that's the thing about Dio is that you want to hate him, but you can see how he has so much charisma as well.
Right.
Like, you can get why he gets all these people on his side, even though he's really an asshole. Like, you know, like, but he sort of has that sort of special quality that you love to hate him kind of thing.
Yeah, he's definitely got that badass kind of heel quality that you love to hate for sure.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, I just think overall, it's just a brilliant series. Like, I really can't state it enough how good I think it is. And I mean, I wouldn't say I'm like, because I know that there's a lot of really big fanboys out there that feels like JoJo does no wrong. But, and I mean, don't get me wrong, I think there's certain parts in JoJo that certainly aren't like super fantastic. They do have some weak parts, but overall, I've got to just say it's probably one of the best. Best series I think I've ever read, like, easily, so.
Yeah, it's real solid. It's definitely a must-watch if you're an anime fan, for sure.
Yeah, for sure. And it's definitely in my top 10. Like, and I only started reading it like last year, so you know, to break into my top 10 like so
Yeah,
quickly is pretty
it's pretty
impressive.
good.
I'm also super picky, so that
Season surprise, you had 10.
doesn't help. They're not in any particular order
Yeah.
except for maybe like first three, I'd probably argue, are probably in order, and that's about it.
We'll have to do a special episode one day where we go over our top tens.
Yeah, that would be really cool. I'd like to do that. So, I also was thinking we could do something where we go over the worst anime we've ever seen.
Well, that's easy. Dragon Pilots.
I wish that was the worst I'd seen. No, there's this one anime called Gazi's Wing. Ooh,
Brutal.
ooh, oh man, it's an abomination would be an understatement for it.
Ouch.
I think. It's quite bad. It's certainly worth watching just to see how bad it is, though.
It's a train wreck just waiting to happen.
It's kind of like the Room of animes,
Oh, jeez.
like so. But the Room is definitely more entertaining because I'd re-watch the Room over re-watching Gazi Wing for sure. But it's one of those things where you got to watch it once to sort of understand just how bad it got. Like, I think it doesn't help that the dub is completely horrendous as well, which doesn't help the situation, but I don't think it would have saved it if it'd been good anyway.
So, what else have you been reading this week or watching? Anything else?
Well, Vagabond is really the big one,
Yep.
which is really good. I started reading it on whim. Because, you know, I've got my manga app, and I was just kind of scrolling through some of the popular mangas.
Right.
And I noticed this Vagabond one, and I'm like, oh, okay, this looks cool. Because I like kind of like samurai period manga, you know. So I pressed on, and it's like, it's a manga based on the life of the legendary, you know, Minamoto Musashi. And I'm like, done. Like, as soon as I read that, I was like, yes, I'm definitely reading. Because he's like the one of the most famous samurai duelists ever. Like,
Okay, like in real life, like
yeah. So it's
gotcha.
actually based on a real person,
Okay,
and it
cool.
has real famous swordsmen in it.
Oh, nice.
Now I can't say that it's historically accurate, like totally, but
Right, but it's
you get
based
it.
on.
Yeah,
Yeah.
exactly. For one thing, he doesn't necessarily win every single duel he's in. So there is some, and I understand that because, you know, when you make a life about a guy who wins every duel,
Right.
there's sort of like no risk to him, if you get what I mean. Like,
Yeah, it's like
so
if he
he
loses once, he's dead, right?
yeah, exactly. Or even if he loses, he's seriously injured. Like,
Yeah.
so you read through it because not every samurai duel was necessary to the death, but
Right,
a lot
true.
of them were, like 90% of them were. But you know, reading through it, you're like, well, if you can never lose, there's no sort of tension. But
Right.
so they sort of made it so that he gets pretty close, or he kind of draws, or he morally wins, as in like he definitely won, but he's really badly like screwed up now. A lot of the duels at the beginning are all done with bokkens, is what they're called, which are like wooden practice swords.
Right.
So, like, don't get me wrong, you can still cave someone's head in with a
Yeah.
bokken; they're very heavy. But you know, the chance of them cutting someone's arm off is slim to none.
Right.
So, but no, it builds tension really well. It's a very interesting read. You can definitely tell there's enough history there that you sort of get a good idea on what was going on. But there's also enough changes there to make the plot interesting as well. Not that the life of this guy was uninteresting. He was the greatest duelist ever. So, but you know, like it's not just a complete. He's not just a complete winner all the time. He wasn't.
That sounds pretty cool.
Yeah. So, 64 duels he had in real. And he won all 64 of them, which is impressive, honestly.
And then what?
Actually, in fact, you may have heard of his book because he wrote a book on being a samurai just before he died. It's called The Legend of the Five Rings, which there's a card game based around it. Like, so there's a setting that's kind of like fantasy Japan called right. Legend of the Five Rings. So he wrote that book, and it is a pretty good read. It's dense, so but it's a good read. I've read it. But yeah, so he also wrote the that book as well. Basically, it just teaches you how to be a good samurai. That's cool. Yeah,
like his memoirs.
Yeah, it's a lot of be prepared to die at any moment kind of stuff. Like,
yeah.
That's how you be a samurai, but be prepared for death like every day. Like,
yeah.
Which is pretty much how samurai kind of did live. Like, they were prepared to die at a moment's notice, basically. So yeah, it's a really good read if you get the opportunity. I'm up to chapter 150. I don't know how many chapters there are. I think there's like 300. I think it might be done. Like, I think they actually finished it.
Right.
But holy crap, yeah, the first 150, can't put it down.
That's pretty good praise.
Yeah, like... oh man, it's just so well written. Like, oh, and all the characters... They do a really good job at making every character sympathetic. So when Minamoto goes into a duel with someone, you've kind of learned some of their backstory, and you're like, I don't want either of these guys to die,
right.
But one of them is going to. Like,
otherwise, you're just always cheering for the main guy, right?
Yeah, exactly. So I think it paints the world in gray, which is a good way to handle the issue, right. I think. Which is something that I find... Like, yeah, as you said, a lot of things would paint the villain guy as some complete utter asshole. But, yeah. You know, not everyone he duels is an asshole. They're yeah. just...
Not everybody he duels is a Nazi.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And, you know, and it, especially because a lot of them... Because I'm not sure if you know about this battle, but the Battle of Sekigahara basically happens right at the start of the manga.
So, okay.
A lot of these guys have just come from there. For those of you who don't know, the Battle of Sekigahara is basically the end of the Sengoku era, which is the era of warring states. So it's when Tokugawa beat kind of like the other samurai, and he became the shogun, the first one in like 100 years or something right. that actually had power to do something. So, you know, once that happened, there was like 300 years of peace, and then there was the Meiji era, which is kind of like... the sort of like 1900s area of Japan, like where samurai started to kind of not be as important, and then they sort of like, you know, disappeared over the hundreds of years after that. So,
right.
So basically the Battle of Sekigahara has just happened, and there's all these sort of like wandering souls who, you know, the era of war is over and they don't know what to do anymore. So they duel each other basically. Because, you know, a lot of these guys, the only thing that they're being told to do is fight.
Right.
So
right.
Now that there's no more battles to fight, how are they meant to find glory and honor?
Right.
So that's sort of like where we're at. So there's sort of a somewhat depressing overtone as well, like over all these characters, because they really sort of don't have a massive purpose outside of fighting. So, you know, but it's a good read, definitely. So.
Yeah, it's almost like samurais, they're like, you know, they're kind of born and raised to do one thing, and then that's all they know, right?
Yeah, exactly. Like, you know, some samurai will, you know, they'll do calligraphy and stuff like that, like, you know.
Right.
But all these guys are ronins, so they're all wandering swordsmen, basically, right. So... They don't have a master. They don't have anyone to look after them. They're going to make money by doing what they do, and that happens to be kill people. So trying to figure out, like, how they're going to make money, how they're going to survive, you know, running into another swordsman at any moment could mean death, because a lot of these guys, they want to be the invincible under the sun is the term that's thrown around a lot.
Right.
Yeah, they all want to be the best swordsman ever. So eventually they're going to have to kill basically every other swordsman. That's kind of like the idea. Very Highlander-esque, I guess. You know, there can only be one sort of thing.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's kind of like a perfect analogy. Like, you just think of like a Highlander and stuff, and the way he lives his life and traveling around and always kind of looking for that. Always kind of looking for that one person that's going to finally stop him and take his life.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, eventually someone wins the prize. the invincible under the sun in this particular scenario. So yeah, it's a great read. I've really been enjoying it, but I do like those sort of samurai period pieces as well. So, you know, I guess if you're like, oh, I hate that samurai period shit, I don't think this
it's one's not for you.
But
yeah,
because it's definitely very entrenched in that samurai culture. So, I see you got Love, Death, and Robots on your list.
Yeah, so I was checking out this series on Netflix, and it's a series of short films, and it's all about it's all like some of them are animated, some of them are like CG, some of them are like live action, and it's really cool. Like you know, look, the first I've only watched the first two or three, and one will be about like three robots, and they're kind of all like walking through like post-apocalyptic America, and they're like checking out, and this is like they're looking back on all the stuff that we used to do like 20 years ago. So like they're looking at the TV, and they're like looking at like a soccer ball, and like looking at all these different things, and like wondering what we use them for, and just kind of that type of stuff, and making like funny quips. And but they're only like you know, 8 10 15 20 minute long videos. Like they're really really short videos.
That's pretty cool. I've always thought that concept is actually a really novel idea, sort of like what would future historians kind of think of our society.
Yeah.
But in this case, it's a robot, you know, like instead of a historian sort of thing. So I've always thought that concept is kind of interesting, you know.
Yeah, they have a lot of like guest appearances by like well-known actors and stuff too in each episode. Like it's pretty cool.
Oh yeah, it's always nice to sort of that sort of have recognizable voice. I always hate it when you like you hear a voice and you're like, who's that guy?
No, yeah. Like for example, like I think it was episode 2 or 3. They were it was a man and a woman in an apartment, and they heard something in their freezer, and they opened up the freezer door. And there's like a civilization going on in their freezer. And so so they're sitting there like checking out this freezer and watching this civilization go through its you know, go through its like its world and its like its history, and their building and their technology is improving, just like as if you were playing like Civ or, you know, Age of Empires, and it's kind of watching it go, and they would, you know, close the door and come back, and like years had passed inside this freezer. And I don't want to spoil the ending, because it's got a bit of a different ending, but yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, it kind of reminds me of that episode of The Simpsons where Lisa builds a society, and then I think they all nuke themselves or something like that. Like,
yeah,
that's pretty cool. Yeah, no, it's on my list. Someone was like, yeah, you should definitely check that out, Vamps. And I'm like, ah, yeah, I'll get to it at some point. I think Lady Vamps might have actually also mentioned it. She's like, I really want to watch that.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's such a wide variety of like anime styles, and like it's pretty cool like that. Like I think the one I was watching, the Ice Age one, it stars Topher Grace.
Ah, yeah, so, cool. Yeah,
that's pretty cool.
But, yeah, no, I really like those kind of things, because you can see a lot of different things, and they're all sort of themed around the same thing.
Yeah,
like the same sort of pivot point. So you get to see a lot of different animations, and you get to see a lot of different styles, and
yeah, kind of,
you
know, remind me of
something
like,
else you like, so.
Kind of remind me of like the Animatrix.
Yeah, which is like, it's a really good way to find an animation company that you're like, oh yeah, they did really cool work on this, and then you watch their stuff, and you know, sometimes it's like, oh damn. Other times it's like, oh yeah, no, it turns out that they're really good. Like, no. It's kind of like, you know, whenever I'd see there's a production company down here, a distribution company, Madman, and whenever I'd see that sticker on anime back in the day, I'd always be like, oh, this is probably going to be a pretty good anime. Turns out it wasn't so true, but, you know, it was most of the time it was pretty accurate. So the other one, of course, was 4Kids, which I stayed away from like the plague.
Right.
Because, I'm not a big fan of censorship, I guess. Unless it's like, if it's something really sort of actually something that's worth censoring, I can understand it. But generally, I find most of the time they'll censor something and it'll be like stupid. Sanji the chain smoking chef becomes Sanji the lollipop enthusiast. It's like, oh, don't think those two things are interchangeable.
Yeah.
Also, there's that scene where he like gets knocked on his ass on a boat, and the guy's like, "Ha, I beat you!" And then he reaches up to his face, puts a cigarette in his mouth, and lights it, and then gets back up to fight. Like,
Right.
that's way more badass than unwrapping a lollipop,
Putting it in your mouth.
because there's a lot more steps. You know, he's got to pull his cigarette out, he's got to get his lighter out, he's got to light it, and then he's got to get up. Like, makes him seem a lot more badass, but I guess I sort of understand because it was like on Saturday morning cartoon kind of network, but
Yeah, for sure. I guess.
like still like you know I don't think anyone's gonna be like, when I grow up I want to be a chain smoking chef just like Sanji, you
Well,
know.
they're still showing people getting sliced up by Zoro, are they not?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I think it's a bit comedy,
Yeah.
but it's like Yu-Gi-Oh! English dub has cartoon sound effects when people try and punch each other or whatever, or they'll just cut away. One of my favorite ones is Joey's being a bitch, and so Tristan punches him to get snap him out of his stupid shit because that's how they communicate normally. And so they cut away just before Tristan throws a punch, and Joey lands on his ass and goes, "Why'd you push me?" And then, but there's like a fist mark on his face.
Yeah.
So they cut away, pretended it was a push, but didn't remove the fist mark on Joey's face.
Oh, so
And
like
it's.
normally you'd see the punch?
Yeah, what happens
Yeah.
in the Japanese version is he punches him full on the face,
Gotcha.
and he falls on his ass, and there's like a big mark on his
Right.
face. But somehow in the 4Kids version, Tristan pushes him, which causes Joey to develop a punch mark on his face. So
Yeah.
either Tristan is the most powerful man in the world who's able
Subtle.
to cause punch marks on
Yeah.
people by pushing them, or something's off. Like, and they even censored a slap. Mai like slaps Joey at one point, and they censored that, and they cut back to it, and but this time they just pretend it never happened.
Yeah.
But there's like a red mark on Joey's face. And they leave the part in where Mai like winds up for the slap as well, so it's like it's pretty obvious what happened.
Yeah, it's like
Like,
some of that's fine, but some of it just makes it seem so weird. Like, you know, when they cut it, when
it
they cut out certain things, they just make it look obviously like something's missing.
funnily enough, I do think that if they had have left the punch and the slap in, it would have almost been less obvious, if you get what I mean.
Yeah,
Like,
like you would have just not
because.
even given a second thought about it, right?
Yeah, it would have just been like, well, yeah, people punch people, people slap people. Well, particularly the slap. I mean, because the slap is a pretty big literary technique of like snapping someone out of their funk. You know, they're like, "Oh, woe is me," and then someone slaps them, and they're like, "Stop being an idiot," and then they're like, "Oh yeah, fair point." You know, which is basically what the
Yeah.
situation
Yeah.
was. You know, and as far as the punch, well, in Japanese culture, guys punching each other is kind of like a form of affection. That's how men settle their differences, like kind of thing,
Right.
you know? Like, if you say something insulting, the guy punches you, and then you're like, oh, yeah, no, see what the issue was now, you know? Like,
Yeah.
it's kind of like us saying, not cool, dude. And then they're like, oh, yeah, sorry, man. Kind of like that, but instead
Yeah.
it's punching.
Punching each other in
Yeah.
the
So, I guess it's basically the more manly version.
Yeah.
Bitch slapping someone's to sense like
Yeah.
you punch them in the face instead.
Yeah, it's almost like hitting each other in the face with gauntlets back in the medieval days.
Yeah, exactly. You know, challenging each other to duels.
Yeah, that Love, Death, and Robots is pretty cool. The other one I checked out this week was Kill la Kill. Do you know anything about this one?
I have heard of it. I have been told to watch it, but I haven't done much research on it. So, paint me a word picture.
It's like an anime ass anime. Like when you think of like stylized fights, you think of like scantily clad women. It's directed and written by the same people who worked together on Gurren Lagann, which is kind of like, you know, got the girls in bikinis, kind of got the guys going all out in battles, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And this was really cool. Like, it follows this girl and she's trying to figure out how her father died. And he, you know, it starts off in the beginning and she comes across this outfit. And it's made of these life fibers. And when it feeds on blood from the user, it kind of transforms them into like it powers up, right? So it goes from like a normal sailor outfit. It almost kind of like, it looks like a Sailor Moon type of outfit. But when it feeds on her blood, it kind of goes into like this very like scantily, like there's a tiny bit of like fabric up her crotch. Like it's very, very, very scantily clad outfit, but it's pretty kind of badass, and it talks to her and has its own attitude and stuff. And
cool.
So she's like,
go ahead.
That's okay. So she's like taking on this this academy. Like there's this big academy here, and it's like a high school, but everything's about fashion in this world. Like they all wear these uniforms called Goku uniforms. But they give their wearers, like, special abilities.
Oh, yeah.
So, depending on how many stars you have on your uniform, that's kind of, like, shows your abilities.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty cool.
So the leader of this, high school, the president, Satsuki, she's, like, real badass. She's got, like, a real badass sword, and, Ryuku, she's the main character, and she kind of, like, goes up there to the thing, and she's trying to look for who killed her father. And, she battles in here, and she gets her ass completely destroyed at the beginning. And then she kind of finds this outfit, and she starts learning how to, like, you know, at first, the thing's, like, drinking way too much blood, and she's gonna, like, she keeps getting worn out after, like, she goes in, she kicks ass, and then all of a sudden, she's, like, completely, like, toast, because she's given, it's taken all her blood, and she can't figure out, like, well, you know, why it's not working, right? And then she kind of eventually figures it out, and... I don't want to ruin it, but she kind of powers up and goes into like her ultimate form, and yeah, that's pretty cool. And then the president kind of gets her own outfit and kind of does the same thing, and they have like this epic battle, and it's really cool.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. Definitely sounds like something I should show Lady Vamps.
Yeah, and it's cool too because it's like it takes place in like Tokyo and like at a high school, and Ryuku, she's like She bunks with this really like hyperactive girl named Mako, and her family, and the dad's like a perv, and it seems like the whole family's like a perv. So every time she's like getting into her outfit or nothing, the family's like always like looking at her. It's really weird. Like it's definitely that kind of style of, you know, like really sexualized for her, right? When she's like in these outfits. But it's really cool though. It's kind of funny. That the art style is really cool. I like it so far. It's really cool.
Yeah, no, it's always good to, it sounds like it's pretty good. I'll certainly show it to Lady Vamps at least, so.
And they have a video game coming out too, at the end of the month, actually.
Ah, that's pretty awesome.
Coming to PS4, Nintendo Switch, PC on July 25th, I think it says.
Oh, nice. I'll have to have a look at that one. I'll definitely be getting that One Punch one. Is that for sure?
Yeah, it looks pretty cool.
So, but yeah, no, you know, video games and anime, I think, go together pretty well. So, it's probably one of the few things that I find, I would say it's a adaptation sort of mishaps, but it seems to be less prone to them. Like, because, you know, movie-based video games generally aren't very, let's be honest here.
Right.
But I find anime-based video games, you know, you'll find some pretty good ones here and there. So.
A little bit better track record, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, that's the thing is that, I dare say I've played more good anime video games than probably terrible movie games, which is quite good, so.
Yeah, well, you'd have a hard time listing off five good movie video games, so.
Oof, yeah, geez. I don't even think I'd list one as that.
Unless they started as games first and then went to movies.
Yeah, that's right. About the only thing. And even then the movie, not the one that gets the short end of the stick.
Yeah, well, I mean, we can't all be Street Fighter the movie.
Oh, yeah, of course. Best adaptation ever. Actually, I'd probably say, the only real movie series that seemed to sort of pull it off was Resident Evil.
Right.
Like, to some extent.
Except they put out 9 movies.
Yeah, that was the issue. Yeah. If they'd stopped at movie number 3, it probably would have been considered an above average series.
Yeah, I agree. They were pretty good.
But yeah, especially once they start introducing the Los Plagas, and they're like, oh yeah, by the way, now they're just normal zombies, sort of, maybe. I don't know. It's like, you didn't really play the games of the Los Plagas in them, did you? You just looked at pictures.
Like, the first couple, maybe. they went out and got a pretty good cast for the first couple, and...
Yeah, well, they had Michelle Rodriguez, who's she's always good. Yeah, and I think, Miller... Oh, God. Jovovich?
Yeah.
Yeah, I hear a lot of people shit on her, but I actually thought she was pretty good in the first 3 movies.
Me too.
Didn't think she was bad. Like, considering... We also got to consider that she's a model, not an actress. That's the other big thing as well. So, I thought she played the role pretty well. And, yeah, I agree. I think there was a lot of good actors in the first couple movies. But then, yeah, they just kind of kept going. And then Wesker had, like, 3 freaking actors or something like that. It's like, dude, and like, really, the first guy was the only one who actually looked like Wesker.
Right.
The second guy looks like Wesker if he, like, decided to just eat Big Macs for a couple weeks. Like, that's not an insult to the guy, or at least I'm trying not to. But, Wesker's very sort of, he's a svelte individual. He's very thin. Like, he's almost like a beanpole. He doesn't look very muscular, The big thing for him is that he's got that super T virus in him that makes him really powerful.
Right.
So, but he could be a fat, overweight nerd and he'd still be as fast, as strong as the virus.
Yeah.
But the guy just looked really freaking bulky. Like, I don't know, maybe it was the outfit he was wearing or whatever. And like, he didn't look super out of shape, but he looked off, like, for Wesker, I guess. Like, so, that was the big thing.
I don't even know who Wesker is, so I'll take your word for it.
Yeah. But yeah, so, to get back to the original issue, I think anime, when being adapted into other things, rather than the other way around.
Yeah, I agree.
So... Even though I haven't seen any of those live-action anime... Oh, no, I lied. I saw the live-action Death Note movie. I really wish I hadn't, but I've seen it.
Yeah, I'm curious how that One Piece one's going to turn out.
Let's just hope if it's better than Death Note, I'll be happy.
Yeah, I know.
Have you seen the Death Note one?
No, I haven't even seen the anime yet.
I watched the anime first and then watched the movie because even though the movie's pretty bad just because the movie's bad, but it's sort of like it ignores all the good things about the source material and takes all the stuff that was sort of a bit iffy, and then they sort of have really bad actors. William Dafoe as Ryuk is actually pretty good, but all the other guys seem to go to the, you'll see those comedy shows where the people, they'll do, a play and they'll, be, really Shakespearean, to the point of ridiculousness.
Right.
That's basically how they act, but seriously. Okay. yes, your honor, but except they're actually trying to act legitimately while doing shit like that. Like,
is that how the anime goes?
No, the anime is actually really well done. Yeah. Even the English dub is pretty good. I mean, I prefer the Japanese, but the English dub is still pretty good. A thing about the only silly part in the English dub is there's this scene where he's explaining how he's basically riding the Death Note without being caught, and he's like, I'm doing my homework, and then I reach into this bag of potato chips, write a name, and take out a potato chip and eat it. It's like, it was much better sort of pace in the Japanese version.
Yeah, I can imagine.
They had to fit all that in like Japanese. Like they had to fit all that explanation in English.
Right.
Like, the Japanese explanation is like a quarter of that kind of thing, you know.
But then the English makes it seem so long and drawn out.
Yeah, it just feels like it's ages because he explains everything in painful detail, basically. But other than that, the English dub is pretty good, so.
Yeah, I have to check it. I've heard good things about that show.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really good anime.
Yeah.
It's not in my top 10, but it is good. Like, it was at one point, but, you know, I've watched a lot of anime since then. So, but it's probably in my top 20, I'd probably say.
Cool.
Like, I'd probably say right at the end at 20, but,
you know. But it's up there. It's not horrible.
Yeah, it's very good, but I've seen like probably hundreds of anime at this point, I dare say. So, you know, some of them obviously aren't going to be as good as others.
Needless to say, there's a ton of anime out there and a ton of good anime.
Yeah, exactly, you know. Because I'd probably say about 120 of what I've watched. Like, so say I've watched 200 animes, which I'm not sure how close that actually is. I would say 120 of them are good, so, you know.
That's pretty good. That's a good average.
Like, so, now the other 80 are horrendous. Like,
right.
Like,
but, I mean, in that 120, you're also talking about, like, some extremely exceptional animes too, right? So.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I'd say if you make it into my top 30, you consider it a very high-quality anime. Like,
yeah.
So, you know. Top 10, obviously, is the cream of the crop, so which is good.
aim for the stars, people. Get into Count Vamps' top 10.
I'll definitely have to sort of try and put it in order, for sure. So yeah,
that's going to be hard to do.
That's the difficult part.
Yeah.
Top 3 I can normally do, but then the other 7 are sort of like, well, they're pretty equal, so...
Yeah.
No. So, but we'll see how we go, I guess.
Yeah, I think that's a good place to end it there. What do you think?
Yeah, I think I've said all I need to say, so...
What about next week? What are we watching this week? Do you have something in mind?
Well, I was actually looking, so I'm not sure how much you know about the Seven Samurai. Or the Seven Ronin is also called. Samurai 7 is what it's called. It's basically a sci-fi version of the Seven Samurai, like the sort of movie.
Yeah.
And I was thinking maybe we could give that a watch. I think there's about 10... there's more than that. But, you know, we could watch the first 3 episodes of that. So.
Okay, what's it called? Seven Samurai?
It's called Samurai 7 on Netflix. Came out in 2004 by the looks of it. I'm really kind of upset that I haven't heard of this beforehand. the Seven Samurai is 7 Ronin basically end up in this village and they're about to be attacked by bandits. And so these 7 Samurai decide to help defend the village from these bandits.
Right.
It's a very old classic Japanese movie. It's in fact, Star Wars took a lot of sort of inspiration from it, the fighting in it. So George Lucas is like, the Seven Samurai is sort of like where I got a lot of my film techniques and stuff like that. So, it's a very good movie. So I'd be interested to see what a sci-fi version of it would look like.
All right, cool. I'll have to go check it out somewhere else because it doesn't look like it's on the Canadian version.
Ah, damn.
It's no big deal. It's only 3 episodes. I can go check it out somewhere else.
All right, cool. So, yeah, we'll check out Samurai 7.
Samurai 7 also kind of where the Magnificent 7 got their
story from? So, it's the same. The Magnificent 7 is basically the same story, but with
cowboys. But Western, right, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought I always heard that the Magnificent 7 was always a take on... The Samurai 7.
Yeah, yeah. And the thing is, it's a really well told story. Like it's got a lot of it's got a lot of soul in it, I guess would be the best way to put it, you know. And a lot of things are based around it, and it was very inspirational for the time. It is a fantastic movie.
Right.
Obviously, this is an anime show, and this is a live-action movie I'm talking about, but, you know, I definitely recommend it, though, if you got the chance, so.
Yeah, cool. I'll look forward to checking that out.
So, yeah. So, sci-fi version sounds good, then.
Yeah, I'm in.
All right, cool. All
right, man, let's get out of here.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you, everyone, for joining. Really appreciate it. And, hey, we'll catch you on the next podcast.
Yep. See everybody next week. All right. Later.
All right. See you.
Ladies and gentlemen, you can find the show on all your favorite podcast apps. Google Play, iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, and Spotify. Just search The Grand Line. If you want to send us a comment, correction, or a question, feel free, or suggest an anime for us to check out. Email us at grandlinecast@hotmail.com. You can also check out the show over at grandlinecast on Twitter. And you can follow Vamps and myself on Twitter and Twitch. And all our links are in the podcast description below. Have a good night, everybody.